हरि ओम। प्रणामस्तु पूज्य स्वामी स्वरूपानंद जी, स्वामी अनुकूलानंद जी, एंड वेलकम बैक एवरीवन फॉर आवर सेकंड पैनल डिस्कशन दिस आफ्टरनून। दिस मॉर्निंग वी हर्ड द ब्रेव एंड हीरोइक टेल ऑफ टू वेरी इनक्रेडिबल वॉरियर्स दैट फाइट्स फॉर इंडिया एंड आवर बॉर्डर्स। बट टुडे वी हैव विद अस श्री संजीव सान्याल जी, हु इज़ अ वॉरियर ऑफ अ डिफरेंट काइंड, a warrior that India needs today, an intellectual kshatriya. I invite Sri Anukulanand ji to please introduce Sanjeev ji.
Sanjeev Sanyal ji, in one small sentence, is the Chanakya of the modern times. Every day, each one of us are impacted by the policies he guides, by the policies that the government makes. As the session goes, we'll know so much more about him. An Indian economist, a writer, environmentalist, and an urban economist. He's the principal economic advisor to the government of India. He's taken India's name really, really high. He won the Young Global Leader 2010 award at the World Economic Forum at Davos. He is a Rhodes Scholar and an Eisenhower Fellow. He is an author of four best-selling books. One of them, which is the most famous right now, is The Ocean of Churn. He works on financial markets. He is known for his great debates which he had in the UN, where the UN on how the population trend would be. He is one who opposed that idea and has presented his own ideas. Another thing that he spoke about is how the normal economists are talking about bringing some balance in economical growth in all the countries, and he said that's not possible. He's really famous for that. He's on the steering committee of Urban Age at LSE Cities. He's a senior fellow of the World Wildlife Fund. He's the co-founder and director of GIST, a think tank that is a pioneer in the field of environmental accounting. He is closely involved with the Avishkar Micro Venture Fund, which won UN's World Business Award in 2006. He is an adjunct fellow at the University of Policy Studies at the National University of Singapore and a visiting scholar at the Oxford University. He joined the board of governors of AFPRO, one of the largest organizations working on food security, and has also advised the UK government, United Nations Environmental Program, and other international agencies. CNBC profiled him as the Young Turk in recognition of his contribution to Asia's financial markets. The Singapore government honored him as the Young Leader 2014 at the World Cities Summit. In 2014, again, he won the first International Indian Achievers Award for his contributions to literature at the inaugural gala event in Mumbai. He is a fellow of Royal Geographical Society, London, and IDFC Institute, Mumbai. This is the introduction for one person, okay? Patriotism runs in his blood, and it came to him through the genes. His great-grandfather was Nalinaksha Sanyal, who himself was a very, very powerful freedom fighter who supported the Congress at that time. His granduncle is Sachindra Nath Sanyalji, who was one of the founders of the revolutionary movement and a mentor to revolutionaries like Bhagat Singh and Chandrasekhar Azad. They considered him as their guru. Sanjeev Sanyalji was born in Calcutta and studied at St. Xavier's School and St. James School. He attended Sriram College of Commerce, Delhi University, and St. John's College, Oxford, where he studied on Rhodes Scholarship. So here we have Sanjeev Sanyalji, who's directing the economical growth of our country, with us to talk to us about how this country is heading. Apart from being an economist, he's trying to revive the real history of India. So we've got a combination of a historian and an economist and a future visionary, past, present, and future in one person. Thank you for being here, sir. Carry on.
Thank you, Swamiji. I now request Swami Swarupananji to give Sanjeev Sanyalji a small token of our appreciation.
India has two kinds of people. One who have left thinking, and those who have right thinking. And if those people follow, or those who leave thinking, they will have nothing left to think. So therefore, thinking is of different types. One is you think without any knowledge. Second, we think with half knowledge. But third, which is the worst, is to think with wrong knowledge. Today is a world of propaganda. And it doesn't matter whether it is right or wrong, it is a world of propaganda. And propaganda shapes our thoughts, and our thoughts shape our decisions. The propaganda is also about the past, which shapes our attitude, which shapes our decisions. And our decisions decide our present and our future. And therefore, to have right thinking, to have right knowledge by which we can make right decisions is extremely important. So it is for that purpose that we have this particular session. Sanjeevji, as I mentioned to you, is both a historian and an economist rolled into one. Is our history that we study telling us the truth? How is it shaping our decisions and thought? There are a lot of myths parading as the truths. Aryan invasion theory. Some of us even believe the British did good for us by colonizing us. There are also ideas that this freedom struggle, has been lopsided in its record. And now, recently, when we talk about it, there is a lot of propaganda happening that Hinduism is becoming intolerant. That caste system is a creation of Hinduism, but is it true? So what has real history to tell us about all of this? What is the position of women in Indian culture? Were women degraded in Indian culture? Is that the truth? Are we even going back to the actual text to understand what is propaganda and what is the truth? All these are questions that the modern youngster is faced with. And if the modern youngster does not get the right sources in order to study and understand, then the modern youngster is going to be confused, and from confusion comes wrong decisions. And therefore, in today's world of information technology, it is important to access the right information. We have been a land of great military glory, cultural glory, technological glory. What happened? Why did we fall? How do we revive ourselves? These are questions that all of us have. And coming to the present, what is happening to our Indian economy? Are the policies which the government is following, are they right? Sometimes they're bringing us a lot of discomfort, but is that fine? These are different questions we will take up. And we will also look at what is going to be India in the future. And we have such a beautiful person as Sanjeev Sanyalji, who's guiding and directing all of this in the country, to come and speak to us. So I give the stage to Sanjeev Sanyalji to speak to us on the history part and then we will take up the talk on economics. Over to sir.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. So Swamiji is all. ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to come here and speak to an excellent gathering of young minds. And I hope I'll be able to give them some answers to the questions you raised and then answer the questions that they will raise. Now, this issue about Indian history has now become quite a hot topic. In fact, has been for a few years now. And I'm going to give you a flavor of why I think there is a very good case for beginning to rethink Indian history. And the line that I love using is an African saying, which basically goes as follows. Until the lions have their own storytellers, the history of the hunt will always glorify the hunter. So until we learn to tell our own story and continue to think of ourselves in the ways others define us, we will continue to be their slaves. So it's very important that we tell our own story. But there is a real problem that 70 years after independence, we still do not tell our own story. And when we do, there are enormous biases in this. So what I'm going to try and do is to give you some sense of the kinds of bias. They're not the only kinds of bias there. There are many others. But I'll give you some sense of the big ones. Now, the first and most obvious bias of Indian history is that most of the textbook history that you have been forced to read, and I was also forced to read, is not the history of India. It is the history of Delhi. So you and I have been forced to memorize the names of large numbers of kings of Delhi, including obscure dynasties like the Lodhis. And yet, there are large parts of the country which are not even mentioned in our history narrative. So unless you happen to be from Tamil Nadu, you probably never heard or know very little about the Cholas and Pallavas. You probably heard very little, unless you happen to be from the Northeast, about the great Ahom kings who ruled over that part of the country for 600 years. You probably not heard much about Lalitaditya, who set up the Kashmiri king, who set up this huge empire in the north of India. You probably not heard of Satvahanas, the Chalukyas. So the problem here is that essentially we have left out the narrative of India almost entirely. And God forbid you happen to be coming from some place like Goa or Sikkim, you do not even exist in the history book. So this is a very major problem. India needs to grab back its narrative from Delhi. So this is the first most important thing that we need to do. The second very important thing we need to do is to recognize that a large part of the way we think of our narrative is even today, 70 years after independence, heavily dominated by the way the colonial rulers had told the story. We have just, without updating it, blindly continued with the stories. Have you noticed that when you're reading your history books, that no matter when the battle happens, the Indians always lose? Have you noticed that? So the three battles of Panipat, Indians lose. Battle of Buxar, Indians lose. Battle of Tarain, Indians lose. Battle of Plassey, Indians lose. So now, surely, given that we are still here, we must have won some battles at least. But those battles were, and our successes were simply systematically removed from our narrative. And so, as a result, we have been left with this impression that we never won anything and we are a bunch of losers who were always meant to be colonized by somebody else. This is essentially a narrative that a colonizer was telling us in order to dominate us. And yet we have imbibed it to such an extent that we do not even think about it. So for example, we all know about Mahmud Ghazni and Muhammad Ghori. And you get the impression from reading our history books that, you know, one of them came and a few years later the other one came. But in fact, the last invasion of Mahmud Ghazni happened in 1025. Mahmud Ghori turned up in 1192. There was a 175-year difference between the two. So why was there such a long, big difference? The reason for that is very simple. In 1033, the nephew of Muhammad Ghazni raced down from the Afghan mountains, and he fought his way through to the Gangetic plains, where he was met by a local king. The king's name was Suhail Dev Passi. And in 1033, in the Battle of Bahraich, Suhail Dev Passi completely destroyed the army, the Turkic army that had come. And the massacre was so big that for 175 years after that, the Turks didn't dare to come back. Now this has been wiped out of our history books. And there are many, many such. I'll give you another. How many of you here are from Kerala? So now, except for you, let's see how many people have heard of Martanda Varma. So if you're not from Kerala and you heard of Martanda Varma, raise your hand. Very, very few people. Now, Martanda Varma is not an important person only in Indian history. He was an important person in world history. So let me rewind you back to the early 18th century. In the early 18th century, what was going on? The Dutch East India Company was the most powerful maritime power in the world. In fact, they had conquered what is now Indonesia. They had conquered South Africa. They had conquered Sri Lanka. And it looked like it was only a matter of time before they began to take over India. When they came across a man called Martanda Varma, who was the king of a very small kingdom in the southern tip of India. And in a battle called the Battle of Kolachal, on the beach, he completely destroyed the Dutch. And he defeated them so badly that from that point onwards, the Dutch East India Company went into decline. Now this was a major, major event, because but for this event, I would be giving you this talk in Dutch. And not only that, the decline of the Dutch East India Company is what allowed the English East India Company to come up. So it was a world event. And from that point, and I think this battle was fought in 1732, if I'm not mistaken, and then till 1905, when the Japanese defeated the Russians, no Asiatic power defeated a European power. Now, even Indian textbooks talk about the Japanese defeating the Russians. Worldwide, everybody knows that 1905, Japanese defeated the Russians. But even Indian textbooks don't tell you that the previous to that, the last guy who had done it was Martanda Varma. Just imagine. We have wiped this fellow off our memory. In most other places, he would be there in every other. So similarly, in Assam, did you know that at the height of the Mughal Empire, when the Mughals invaded Assam, the Assamese managed to coax the Mughal army onto a naval battle on the Brahmaputra, where a general called Lasit Borphukon completely destroyed the Mughal invaders. Again, unless you happen to be from Northeast, you probably never heard of Lasit Borphukon. And these are just individuals. There are entire empires that have been wiped out of our memory. So from our textbooks, you will get the impression that the Mughals ruled India, and then a few years later, the British took over India. What they don't tell you is that there is a fairly long gap between the two, and that for something like 70 years, a large part of India was ruled by the Marathas. In fact, they ruled India from Punjab all the way to southern India to Tamil Nadu. Now, this was a huge empire. In fact, their empire was larger than that of Akbar. And yet, the Maratha period has been wiped out. Why? Because it was an inconvenient period to the British narrative that foreigners have always ruled India. In fact, they were so keen on this narrative, they invented a completely fictitious invasion called the Aryan invasion theory to basically tell us that, look, this civilization you're very proud of is actually also a gift from some white people. And all we are doing by conquering you is giving you a software update. So the net result of this is that our narrative has now got to be captured back and rewritten by ourselves. So this is the second major problem in our narrative. The problem was that after we became independent, rather than correct these narratives, a new group of rulers came about and they wanted to add in their narratives. They were both, of course, there was the Congress Party and the Gandhi dynasty specifically. And of course, in the intellectual spaces, they were the Marxists. And what they did is that they inserted their own biases into the story. So I'll just give you one example of it. Now, if you were reading the history of the India's freedom struggle from the British, you would get the impression that it was a uniquely peaceful fight for independence, which led by Mahatma Gandhi and the Congress. And the story would go to give you the impression that, you know, we politely asked the British to leave and they very graciously left. Problem is that this is not the real story. There were many other movements to liberate India from British rule, including several which were armed revolts. Now, because it's still in fairly recent history, people still know the names of a few of them, like Bhagat Singh. You'll have heard of Udham Singh perhaps, maybe of Chandrashekhar Azad and a few others. But the impression you get is that these are random people carrying out some random acts of individual bravery, and that really it had no real impact on the overall story. That is actually not true. The revolutionaries were an organized group of people starting in the 1910s who had embassies in the First World War in places like Japan and Berlin, who organized major efforts like the Gadar movement. Please read about all these. That they were, during the Second World, of course, thanks to Subhash Bose's INA, you know a little bit about. But you know, other than these random things, you don't understand that many of the people who participated in this were the same people with the same agenda working together over a long period, 40, 50 years. And that is simply left out of the story. So you give the impression that they were individual acts of bravery and nothing else. Whereas this story can be told in a completely different way, incidentally, and it gives you a very, very different impression of why, in the end, India became independent, culminating in, of course, the 1946 when you had the naval revolt in Bombay. It had nothing to make with making salt. Now, that is a totally different story, wiped out of our memory. I am personally slowly researching this story. And it's an extraordinary story of espionage and individual courage and so on. So hopefully in a couple of years' time, you'll be able to read this story. But the point I'm making to you is this is another bias. And I'm going to finish with the last bias that I think is that women have been wiped out of our history books again. This is astonishing because unlike the histories of many other parts of the world, Indian history is actually full of powerful, interesting women. This is unique. And yet we don't hear very much about them. How many history books tell you about Ahilya Bai Holkar? Or the great resistance of Durgavati to Akbar? Or the resistance of the three Ranis Abakka of Ullal, who fought against the Portuguese? And of course, the only one you probably hear about is Rani Jhansi, Lakshmi Bai. And even that is not because of your history books, but because of that poem that all of you had to learn in Hindi class in class 7. So, the point here is this. We need to put a very large proportion of our population back into the history books. Half of the population has simply been wiped out. And yet, India is unique in having sizable parts of the country run by matriarchal societies. Some of them are matriarchal even today. Very powerful queens, very unlike many other parts of the world. We had many, many, over long periods of time, many powerful queens. Enormous contributions to different things, from religious texts to science to literature. It's just amazing, and yet we have wiped all of this out of our memory. So this is just a sort of a grand smattering of why we need to rewrite our history books. With that, let me hand the mic back.
Thank you, Sanjeev. Thank you, Sanjeev ji. There is one more myth that's running around, as I mentioned in the starting, that Britishers were not really so bad. In fact, they left us with wonderful systems, like the railways, like the postal system, like the police. So the question among some intellectuals is, why are we so angry with them? Did they leave us with a blessing, or did they still damage all of us?
See, history is history. And you have to understand that, of course, the British ruled India. They carried out what are unspeakable acts of genocide in India. There were large numbers of famine going back to the 18th century in which maybe, you know, 18th century, large numbers of in the 19th century, but the last great famine that happened is in living memory in 1943 in Bengal, when 3 million people died of starvation because the British removed all the food from eastern Bengal because they were afraid the Japanese were going to come in. So basically, in order to make sure that the Japanese would not have any food when they came through Bengal, they removed all the food supplies. And as a result, 3 million people died. And this is not something long ago. There are still people alive who remember this. And this is just one thing. I mean, the business of starving millions of people dead. And incidentally, this was not even a unique thing that they did in India. They perfected this art in many other places, including right next door in Ireland, where they wiped out such a large proportion of their population that even today, Ireland has a lower population than it did 200 years ago. It was such a catastrophic. So this was something they did systematically around the world. Now, sure, they did build the railways. But you know, I keep telling people that, look, Hitler also built great autobahns. So the fact that Hitler built great autobahns doesn't change our view, at least certainly for the Jews did not change the view of how Hitler treated them. So in exactly the same way, does the fact that they built railways did not change my view of the British. Now, this is not to blame present-day British people for their crimes of the past, but at the very least, they've got to stop being patronizing about what they did here and accept it, because not accepting what the British colonial rulers did in India is equivalent to denying genocide and denying the Holocaust.
Right. There's a very interesting metaphor which I heard regarding what British left with us. A robber came into a house and stole all jewelry, but he entered from the roof. So he brought a rope and he brought a ladder. And then when he went back, he left the ladder and the rope. And then when the police came, they said, be grateful to the robber because they left you with a ladder and a rope. It's equal to saying what the British left with us. Though they looted us with everything, they left for us such beautiful things. So coming from the past to the present, Narendra Modi ji talks about churn, manthan. And of course, all of us know that the country is going through a manthan, and all of us are part of the churn. Our Prime Minister talks about new India is emerging. There's new India growing. And you are very much a big part of that. So would you please explain to us in the economic perspective as to what is this new India emerging and what are we looking forward to?
You're absolutely right. Prime Minister talks about manthan, he talks about churn, he talks about new economics from a new India. But what does this really mean? Yes. See, what he's really trying to do is to do the following. He's trying to take a political economy that is essentially based on hierarchy, on rent seeking, and on patronage, and move it to a society and a political economy that is based on social mobility, risk taking, and entrepreneurship. Now, this is a very different dynamic about how it worked. Till now, what was our political economy? So, till 1991, we had socialism without entry. Unless you could get yourself a license, you couldn't enter. So it was socialism without entry. After that, you had capitalism without exit. And what was the basis on which this was functioning? Was elite capture of all kinds of natural resources, as well as of the financing of the system. So basically what happened is, supposing I am a big industrialist, I take on a huge loans, and let's say I succeed. Then, if I succeed, then I become captain of industry, I appear on CII and ASSOCHAM and all these boards, and I lecture everybody how to be great entrepreneurs, and every year when the budget is presented, I give it 10 on 10, and so on and so forth. But if you fail, what happens? Now, if you fail, nothing much happens. All that happens is because your friends in the political system basically ask your banks to roll over the loan. And you keep rolling over these loans till someday, by chance, you succeed. Meanwhile, the taxpayer essentially bails you out. So this is how things have been going on since independence. Now, this problem is not a new one. Those of you interested in the history of this, please go back and read about 1955. There was something called the Mundra scandal, when LIC was nationalized. And at that time also, what had happened is that the capture of the LIC, the funds of this insurance company, was being handed out to friends and family of the political establishment of that time. And it led to a major scandal. And then as a result of that scandal at that time, the finance minister of that time in 1955 was forced to resign. But did that stop? No. Instead, we went further and nationalized all the banks. And the net result is that the political economy ended up capturing all the financial resources in the country. Now, the same thing was done with licensing. If you were friend and family of the political establishment, you got your license. And this is how the economy ran. In 1991, finally, the economy collapsed. This licensing part was gotten rid of, but the financial part continued. And it continued till now, till the banking system basically fell apart. And that is the point at which, about a year and a half ago, we decided we had to do something and stop this. And even if it was going to be painful to stop this, we had to do it. Because this was not just about reviving the bank for one round, but changing the culture of this country. So if you, those of you who are into economics will remember this, that 1 year ago there was a lot of talk about bad bank. Now what is a bad bank? Bad bank is the idea that you take all these assets from these ailing banks, stick them into another institution, let's call it the bad bank, and they stay there, and you recapitalize the banks, and the banks begin to lend again. Now this, in some ways, is the most painless way of doing it, because the banks will go back to lending, these bad assets will be put in, somehow kept going inside this bad bank, and we'll live happily ever after. But there is a problem. First, this bad bank is basically a warehouse for keeping alive the mistakes of the past. It's not a shutting them down. Similarly, the banks now have been recapitalized. They'll go back to doing what they were doing before. They have not been taught a lesson. So instead, it was decided to do something quite risky. That is to use a completely newly minted act called the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. It had been passed in 2016. And we decided that we will use a completely untested system to take all these bad assets and to liquidate and bankrupt them and sell them off. Now, this is a painful thing to do. And if they had, and not only that, this was an untested system, brand new. We had new courts, that NCLT, the tribunals that were supposed to go into do this, and nobody knew how it was going to be. But nevertheless, it was decided to take the chance. And the reason we had the courage to do this is because we discovered that only about 50 cases accounted for 2/3 of the problem. Which is not surprising because a very tiny elite had captured all the resources. So maybe there were thousands of bankrupt people, but in fact they didn't account for very much. It was 50 cases that accounted for something like 2/3 of the problem, because it's basically an elite capture problem. So let's bankrupt those 50 cases. Now there is a process. There is a process of 180 days plus 90 days. That process has just come to an end. And those of you will know, just last week, the first big case, Bhushan Steel, was bought by the Tatas for 35,000 crores in cash plus 12% equity sale, which is 40,000 crores of money was brought back into the banking system. This, ladies and gentlemen, is just the first step. More of these will happen in the next few months. And with this, we are not just cleaning up the banks, we are changing the culture of the country. That you cannot randomly milk the banks and the taxpayers to basically perpetuate personal interests of a few. The personal interests of capitalists is not capitalism. What you need is creative destruction, a system of entrepreneurship, risk-taking, and continuous churn. That's why the word churn. That's why when you heard the word churn, it's about risk-taking. Much of this risk will go wrong. That's the nature of the beast. New technologies will come, new business models will come. And so this process must keep churning. There's nothing wrong with this. This is exactly how it must be. And with this churn on the entrepreneurial side, we also want to see a similar churn on the social side, social mobility. We want people to move, to take risks, to study, and through this there will be a churn. So social mobility, entrepreneurship, risk-taking, all of this is a vision of India derived from, directly from the idea of Manthan, which as many of you know, is a central idea in Hindu philosophy.
Right. Now, when we talk about new things like GST or demonetization to a small extent, or the banking laws, there has also been a criticism that maybe it should have been implemented in a better way, or maybe there should have been a lot more preparation and then things should have been done. But we understand that every economic policy has a kind of a philosophy behind it, an idea behind it. You talk about the dog and the frisbee example, which is quite famous. So would you please elaborate on your philosophy behind which you're making your economic policies?
See, we recognize that many of the policies we are introducing, the IBC being one good example, are painful. They're painful because we're shutting down large companies. Obviously, it affects their suppliers. It affects people who work there. And the banks, of course, while they are going through this restructuring, are all unhappy. But somebody has to do it at some point in time. And so the political establishment had the courage to do it. The same thing was true of GST. We were a strange country in which we had 29 states and each one of them had its own essentially tax policy. And it was such a messy system that it was easier for Mumbai to trade with London than it was for Mumbai to trade with Delhi. So in this environment, everybody recognizes, it's not a new thing. We knew this for 20, 25 years, and lots of papers were written about how we needed a unified system. And we debated this in colleges, in universities, think tanks, government. A lot of people wrote lots of op-eds about it. Ultimately, it was decided last year, the Prime Minister decided that we were going to implement this. So immediately, there was a lot of talk that, you know, this has to be done, that has to be done, this has to be done. And of course, till the last minute, nobody was dead sure about how what will work. But the fact is, you can never be quite sure how things will work. And let me explain this through how we think about the world. So I'm going to tell that story about the dog and the frisbee so that you understand our philosophical basis. You see, many of you have dogs. How many of you have dogs? Let's see. Quite a few of you have dogs. And many of you then take your dog to the park and then you throw a frisbee and the dog catches the frisbee. Now, most of you don't think very much about it. But if you were an economist, on the other hand, you wouldn't be satisfied by just throwing the frisbee and your dog catching the frisbee. What you would do is you would first go to the park and measure the speed of the wind. Then you would look at the design of the frisbee. And then you would very closely study the breed of the dog. And then you would take all of this data and stick it into your computer and create an Excel sheet. And on the basis of this Excel sheet, you would get a forecast of where the frisbee is going to land. And if you are a policymaker like myself, you would then form something called a frisbee policy committee. And the frisbee policy committee would give you forward guidance twice a year. Now, based on that forecast, we would then take the dog to where the frisbee was supposed to land, and we would stick a stake in the ground and tie the dog there. Then we would go to the back and throw the frisbee. Now, anybody who has ever thrown the frisbee will realize that it is very unlikely that the frisbee will land anywhere near where the dog was. And so the dog will fail to catch the frisbee. And the economist will be very surprised. Now, the question therefore is, what do the non-economists do which allows their dogs to catch the frisbee? In order to understand this, you have to look at what a dog does. Basically, when you take your dog, you indicate to the dog roughly that you want to throw the frisbee in that direction. So the dog runs a little ahead and waits for you. And then you throw the frisbee. Then what does the dog do? The dog continues to run along with the frisbee and keeps looking at the frisbee. And as the frisbee comes down, it locks in, keeps watching, and then grabs the frisbee. What is the dog doing? Is the dog attempting to create a great plan of where the frisbee will go and forecast it? No. What it is doing is feedback loop and adjust. Indeed, even in something as simple as a park and a frisbee is a complicated place. And it is very difficult exactly to know what is happening. So when you're trying to introduce something as complicated as a GST on a country as complicated as India, it is actually impossible to tell what exactly is going to happen when you do it, till you actually do it. So for 20 years, we spent all kinds of drawing boards, planning commission reports, etc. None of them would have prepared us for what actually happened. Now, yes, you can plan that maybe the website should have been a little bit better. Maybe we should have done better education, this, that. Maybe there should have been fewer rates, which I, by the way, incidentally strongly believe even now should be simplified. But nevertheless, we introduced it. And then we attempted to fix it. Now, what happened in the first 3 months? It didn't work at all. In the next 3 months, we got feedback and we fixed it. It worked somewhat. In the following few months, it worked a little bit better. And now as we come towards the end of one full year of doing this, it generally works. In another 6 months, it will work reasonably well. Now, in the end of doing all of this, we will have a unified tax system for this country. It was painful, but we have almost done it. Meanwhile, many other countries have attempted to do this GST and have abandoned it. Just now, Malaysia has abandoned it. It's not an easy thing to do, and Malaysia is a tiny country compared to us. Many other countries had to do all kinds of things. But we did it. We gritted our teeth. I know all of you cursed us. Certainly, I'm sure if your parents run businesses, you definitely cursed us. But we got it done. Same thing is with the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court. Many people cursed us, but it had to be done. We had to finally do it. And it was painful, but we have done it. So through this process of doing these painful changes, we have ended up with essentially a unified taxation system, and we have created a market-based economy driven by creative destruction.
So we are on the right track.
Thank you. That's for them to decide.
That's nice. I mentioned in the beginning that you're the Chanakya of modern times. That was not without reason. You have been mentioning in your different talks that quite vociferously about your dislike for the history of Ashoka and the king, and also the Ashokan system of governance, the Nehruvian system of governance, and your liking for revisiting the Chanakya system of leadership and governance. So would you please tell us about what you see beautiful in Chanakya and what was wrong about the history of Ashoka as well as these systems?
See, the debates we have about governance are very, very old. And India, being an ancient civilization, has debated this in many, many ways, by the way, over thousands of years. So one of the great debates that were there in the Mauryan times was the contrast between two ways of thinking of the world. One was the Chanakyan way and one was the Ashokan way. Now, there is this impression that Ashoka was a very peaceful king, that he invaded Odisha or Kalinga at that time, what was called Kalinga at that time, that he saw the massacre there, became a pacifist, embraced Buddhism, and we all lived happily ever after. I also basically believed that till very recently, till I began investigating the matter. It turns out that the story is entirely made up. So how did I find this out? So basically what I did was, okay, I went to Odisha and began to look at all the inscriptions in Odisha. Now it's quite amazing that none of the inscriptions in Odisha mention any regret about his invasion. Not only that, the one inscription, the inscription where he does express regret on which this story is based, is not anywhere near, but now he's in Pakistan. And even in that inscription, if you read the very next paragraph about how he's feeling regret, what he says is that, you know, you forest tribes, if you don't behave yourself, I will do exactly the same thing to you. This is not a peace-loving pacifist, number one. Secondly, there are several Buddhist texts which talk about Ashoka, but not a single one of them links his story to his conversion to Buddhism to the story about invading Kalinga. Instead, they have many other stories. But in those stories, including a particular text called Ashoka Vadana, which is widely used by historians, it mentions that he carried out major massacres of Jains, and he carried out major massacres of a sect called the Ajivikas. In fact, there is one story in when one episode in Bengal, 16,000 Ajivikas were killed in a day. There's another episode in which he hears of a Jain family who had drawn the picture of Buddha bowing to a Jain Tirthankara. Now he had that person's family put inside his house along with his family and burnt it down. And then he gave one golden coin to every Jain's head that was brought to him. And that massacre carried on till by mistake somebody slit off the head of one of his brothers, his only surviving brother, because he had killed all his own brothers as well. Now there is, therefore, the story of Ashoka is clearly not about some peaceful thing. What he did do, however, is write these inscriptions, and now the point is, since when have we begun believing the propaganda of Indian politicians? So why should we believe Ashoka? The evidence is very clear. The evidence, to the extent it exists, suggests that he carried out major massacres. Whether he became pacifist or not, who knows? But we also do know that his empire collapsed while he was alive. Clearly not the sign of a great emperor. But what does he say about governance in his text? He is obviously a man who is very much into imposing himself on other people's lives. He says, I am the father to my people. He says, so what does it tell you? He basically believes in my Baap Sarkar. Then he says, I am going to put the Dharma Mahamantas to look after my people. Now what is the modern translation of Dharma Mahamanta? Religious police. So he was not exactly an uninterfering person. Basically, he had a clear view of how he wanted everybody to live their lives, and he was going to impose it. Now, let's take, on the other hand, Chanakya's view of the world. Now, Chanakya, by the way, was not a great libertarian. He was a severe man, and he ruled by... But it's very interesting, however. Chanakya believed in a very strong state, but he believed in a limited state, and he clearly, repeatedly tells the king, a good king is a king with restraint. The king must always restrain himself. In fact, the whole point is, if you allow too much power to your officials, they will become corrupt. So what is he arguing for? He's arguing for a powerful, strong state, but a limited state. Whereas what Ashoka is arguing for is an all-pervasive but weak state. Now, it is not very surprising that Nehru worshipped Ashoka. So what we ended up with is a weak and all-pervasive Nehruvian state. Whereas the Chanakyan state is a more strong state, but it is a limited state. It is not about telling you how to lead your life. The state remains very well contained. It is not, incidentally, a libertarian state. Chanakya had no sense of humor about certain things. But it was a very different way of thinking about the state.
Right. I've read a few writing about Chan, about he even having rules of extreme punishments for people who are taking open defecation. To that extent, he's been so strong on his rules. Now, before we open up the questions to the audience, you explained to us that this narrative, which has been running in our history for the last 70 years, has been making us feel that we are always ruled, has been giving us wrong ideas about who we are, and has been even restraining us from even thinking of ourselves as a glorious culture. Now, we are 800 youngsters here. How do we change this? And so that's one side of the historical question. And coming to the side of economics, what are we to study and understand so that we understand the right aspect and the right understanding of what is happening in the economical policies so that we don't have wrong propaganda influencing us?
So very important is that this story has to be rewritten. I have made some small contributions. But the fact is that there is so much to be done, and so much of the story needs to be rewritten. It will have to be rewritten by you. So I need you to begin to do this and help me do this, help this country do this. But here comes the second part. This has to be done with proper scholarship. It is no point replacing one bunch of lies with another bunch of lies. So we have to do the hard work of scholarship, of gathering evidence, weighing the evidence. There is no need to replace what was clearly erroneous with a completely. Now, this does not mean that we should not have our own viewpoints. Every history is written from a viewpoint. We Indians should be allowed our own viewpoint. Nothing wrong with that. But it has to be done with evidence, because in the end, everybody is allowed their opinion, but they are not allowed their facts. You don't have to agree with each other, by the way, but you definitely have to maintain standards of evidence and scholarship, and only then will this new narrative be built piece by piece. And in order to do that, you have to put in the work, and a new generation of scholars has to be created. And I'm relying on you to do it.
And in terms of economic understanding of what are the economical policies, because all that we have is the media and what they are telling us. So
the media will do whatever its job is to do. It is for you to interpret and take it in and try and understand it. There is a little bit more diversity in views in the media these days than was when I was growing up. Remember, I grew up in communist-ruled Kolkata of the 1970s and 80s. So if you are complaining about propaganda, think about what I had to deal with. While there is obviously a lot more noise, and social media, of course, is very, very noisy and full of all kinds of random facts and figures, nevertheless, even chaotic as it is, this openness is better than what used to be the case. So yes, you need to obviously think about it. You have to use your own minds. The gods have given you a mind, please use it.
Right. So now we've got another 15 minutes, and we would open up the stage for questions. So you could take a couple of minutes for the for you to come up with questions. And the team leaders, please see what the questions are, and you can give chances to them.
What determines rupee value, and what should we do to bring 1 rupee equal to $1 or more?
Well, large number of things determine the value of a rupee. First of all, remember the value of rupee is not absolute. It is a relative thing, relative to another currency. Usually we do it relative to the dollar. Now, the sensible thing about a rupee management is that it depends on many things: the current account deficit, the amount of money that's coming in from foreign investments. It depends on in domestic inflation and real effective exchange rate. Now, I'm not in a position to give you a full class on macroeconomics, but generally making you the point is that at different points in time, there is a different appropriate level of exchange rate. So do not have this mental image that one rupee equal to $1 is something we should all aspire to. No, it's not at all obvious. Japan is a great country, but you know, more than 100 yen required to get $1. That doesn't mean that Japan is a poor country. Japan is a perfectly prosperous country. And in fact, when it was a fast growing economy, it required more than 200 or 250 yen to the dollar. So ironically, as the yen has strengthened, the Japan's economy has weakened. So do not have this mentally, this idea, strong currency means a good thing, weak currency, bad thing. This is a much more nuanced thing than that. And those who control the exchange rate, in this case the Reserve Bank of India, have to take into account these multiple things and balance it. So having this, you know, single-minded approach to the exchange rate with a rigid view of the world is actually not a good thing. I mean, let's say if tomorrow morning, if we fix the exchange rate 1:1, what will happen? Essentially, our exports will suddenly collapse. We will no longer be competitive. There'll be all kinds of other problems. So it is a nuanced thing. There is no ex ante way of deciding that this is the best exchange rate. Far from it. As the world evolves, the exchange rate also has to evolve. Just like the dog has to adjust to the frisbee, we, the Reserve Bank, has to adjust to the world conditions in order to fix the exchange rate and manage it.
Is the Indian economy sustainable, and what are the driving factors going forward?
It depends what you mean by sustainable. I mean, we are currently growing at over 7%. So this is a very high rate of growth. In fact, the highest rate of GDP growth of any major economy in the world. And if we sustain this over long periods of time, we will genuinely become a lot richer. Now, so we are already closing in on being a $3 trillion economy. So this is not a trivial thing. And I think by next year, if I'm not mistaken, we will be the fifth largest economy in the world in dollar terms, and in PPP terms we already are the third largest economy in the world. So we are doing well and we are growing fast. And so there are many interesting things that are happening as a result of this. I'll just give you some flavor of the kinds of things we are doing. Take for example the city I live in, Delhi. 11 or 12 years ago, it did not have a metro. You know that. Now, this year alone, we will add 120 kilometers of new lines in Delhi alone. As a result of which, we will have the fourth largest metro network in the world. And by the end of this decade, we'll become the third largest metro network in the world. Now, that is just in one city. Now, if you went to Mumbai's suburban rail transport system was set up actually in the 19th century. The train dibbas that you see with all those people hanging out, I'm sure you see these photographs of all these people hanging out of the Mumbai trains. Do you know when the last time that design was upgraded? 1920. So after one whole century, we are finally putting in new design bogies with air conditioning. Simultaneously, we are building a bullet train going to Ahmedabad from Mumbai. Simultaneously, we are building a brand new underground railway system in Mumbai. All happening right now. You can visit Mumbai and see it being construction going on right now. In the last 15 months alone, something like 33 new airports are being built under the Udaan scheme. So this is just happening in infrastructure. And you'll see this is in the big cities and all that. Fine. Let's talk about what's happening totally in the rural areas and thing. Beginning of this decade, only 31% of Indian households had toilets. Did you know this? Already that number is at 85. Just from 2011 to now, we have. And that's a huge culture change, quite apart from the aesthetics of it. This is a major breakthrough in public health. And there are multiplier effects of all kinds, from women's safety to health to all kinds of things. So this is a very major thing. Same thing is, for example, just a month ago, the very last village
in India to get an electric connection was finally electrified in Manipur just last month. So we are making progress. A lot of this has of course been built over the work of many governments over the past, not just this of this government. This is sort of standing on work upon work upon work, which we have built upon. But yes, a lot of this is now coming to fruition, and a lot of extra effort is being put by this government to take this forward. And we will do more of this going, there are lots of new plans. Since we were talking about airports being built, a brand new airport is being built in Mumbai. Work has already started. You will be able to fly from that airport within 24 months. So this is not a trivial thing. Earlier we used to take decades building a new airport. A new airport will exist in 24 months. So many, many interesting things are happening in India. This does not mean, however, there aren't problems. There are lots of problems in India. Lots and lots of problems. Is this sustainable? Well, along the way, we will take a lot of knocks. Right now, as a policymaker, let me tell you what is my... I have lots of headaches. The banks, we may have done all this IBC, cleaning up the banks. The fact is, it's not a finished job yet. Many things can go wrong along the way. And a country, an economy of our size, of any size in fact, cannot function without a functioning banking system. So I need to get this banking system out of ICU and functioning again and lending again. So I worry about that. I worry about the fact that global oil prices have now suddenly gone back very quickly to $80 to the barrel. Now everybody's complaining that oil has become very, very expensive. Now I have to make a choice. Do I pass it entirely on to the consumer? They'll be very happy. But if I do that, how will I fund all these things you were clapping for? After all, it also needs money. So I have to make a choice. These are not easy choices to make. And I know that no matter which choice I make, I will get brickbats. But I have to make those choices. But in the end, through this process of risk-taking, adjustment, policy-making, going back, gritting your teeth, we as a nation are coming back after probably something like, maybe not 1,000, but certainly 700 years of decline. And it's a very big deal.
Hari Om, my question is, to a budding author like myself, what is the focus I should keep on? Is it research-based facts or telling a message of change?
Well, like with any creative pursuit, you must do what comes naturally to you. I don't necessarily think that you have to have some message of change or some deep thing. Writing humor is a perfectly good thing to do. There may be no message at all, just for fun. A good writer should write what comes naturally to them and not have this preconceived notion that you have to write some deep thing. Many times, the lightest touch is the best way to get a message through. So, first of all, clear your head of all kinds of preconceived notions of trying to bring into yourself what others expect of you, or trying to be some other writer. You have to be your own writer. That is the single most important thing. Clear out of your head this idea, oh, I need to have some social message. If it really comes from inside, then yes. Otherwise, don't force it. Good writing is good writing. A good writer is able to essentially ultimately be true to himself or herself. So that is what I would say. Be true to yourself rather than have some preconceived notion of what you're supposed to be as a writer.
Hello. Sir, I'm from Sikkim and my name is Pradeep Tamang. And what role can we play as a youth of a small state of Sikkim, fully landlocked by international border, in order to contribute or in order to make a strong national economy?
First of all, give a round of applause for the most beautiful state in India. So just so that you know, I grew up in Sikkim, in Gangtok and Pimyangsi, and my very first memory is that of the Kanchenjunga. So I am very much you know, a lover of Sikkim. I've been there many times over the years, including just a few months ago. It's a beautiful place. There are many things that you can do. One is, of course, as an economy, as you know, we now have a new airport there. And just purely on the basis of keeping it a clean state and keeping it a pristine place, you can make more than keep the economy running on things like tourism, organic farming, etc. I believe your chief minister is already working on this. So that, let that be. So let me talk about a slightly different thing. One of the interesting things I find about a place like Sikkim is that the youth of Sikkim are not engaging enough with their own identity strongly enough. And this is a very important issue, and I'll explain why. You see, there are many communities of Sikkim have unique cultures. And these are part and parcel of the mosaic that makes India. Unfortunately, as a result of a mistaken idea of modernity, these ideas are being frittered away. Whereas the identity of Sikkimese culture is being slowly lost. So I am a big believer that we need to document this. For example, I'll give you one example. When I go to Sikkim, I always ask, can I actually read a history book about Sikkim? I was quite amazed. There isn't a single good history book on Sikkim. There is one which sort of is a history of Sikkim, written by not a Sikkimese person, by a foreigner. This is astounding. How can you have a full state in the country that doesn't know its past? So this is just one example. Similarly, I asked, you know, there are many communities there. Lepchas, Bhutias, even within the Nepalese, there are many groups. They have very interesting customs. Now these customs are slowly being lost because the youth of Sikkim are not interested in maintaining these customs. In fact, many of them think of it as being backward. I think that is very, very wrong, because if you do not preserve your own identity, then you will essentially become nihilist. And this is one of the key reasons, in my view, that you have a serious problem with addictions in Sikkim, because there is no sense of identity. So this sense of identity has to be recaptured. It has to be recaptured from the bottom by reconnecting with Sikkimese identity at the ground level in all its communities, so that a continuity, a sense of self is preserved. So this, I think, is very, very important. So go back and begin to record, write down the old histories, the folklore, the music of Sikkim. Otherwise, modernity will drown you out and you'll be left with no sense of self. So you may become economically rich, but ultimately you will have no anchor.
Thank you, Sanjeev Ji. I'm sure there are many more questions, but before we end, I would like to ask a last question to you. Of course, it's on a personal front. You know, Sanjeev Ji was the Deutsche Bank's global strategist and a managing director till 2015. And that is something amazing to be in on a personal capacity. The theme of this program or this camp has been, the theme that runs through is nation above self. You keep doing so much. For us to run a family economy is not easy. And you're trying to run the economy of the entire country. You write books, you travel, you do so much work. How do you manage all of that? What's the passion that drives you?
Difficult question. I mean, I'm very passionate about many of these issues, as you can see, about history, about urban design, about economics, about cultural issues, and so on. What drives me eventually is the fact that I really feel it in my bones. At some level, I genuinely enjoy this mix of things I do. And in my view, unfortunately, we have ended up putting knowledge in silos. But in fact, reality doesn't live in silos. Reality flows, you know. If you're doing geography, it affects history, but history affects geography. History is affected by politics. Politics is affected by geography, which in turn affects technology. Technology in turn affects history. So they're all interconnected in the real world. And yet, because we have put them in various silos, we have ended up, in my view, ended up with knowledge being put into compartments, which is not true. So I have lived my life with no compartments. This is true for the way I think about knowledge as a free-flowing, organic whole. I've also thought about my own life in the same way. Free-flowing,
without any having any particular plan in mind, when I started out and I was maybe your age, when I was 18, I wanted to actually be a physicist. I'm very much maths and science type. I would never have imagined that I would be a best-selling author. Later on, along the way, I became an economist, but I became a financial markets economist. Before I became a financial markets economist, let me tell you, I had never heard about anybody being a financial markets economist. So it was a completely new field which I just happened to do. I did that for many years, and then suddenly, somewhere down the line, I also became a writer. And then somewhere along the line, about a little over a year ago, I joined this government and became the government's principal economic advisor. Now, if you told me that I was going to plan all of this, then I will tell you that really, which bit was planned? None of it. I just flowed with it because I felt with it. I'm always find that, at least for me, works, may not work for everybody, but in my view, that has always been the case. I have not lived my life based on hard goals. I've lived my life essentially along with the ideas that I believed in.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sanjeev Ji. I know Sanjeev Ji has a program to attend right at 6 o'clock today. He's got a program in Indic Books. And we can meet Sanjeev Ji in a lot of books that he's written. In fact, we want to read history as it is, right? The other viewpoint which talks about facts. And I'm sure reading Sanjeev Ji's books will help us a lot. Apart from his passions with subject, with knowledge, he also goes for treks. And something amazing about him is that all his history books, whichever place he refers to, he has personally visited every place that he writes about. So, Sanjeev Ji, what you do impacts each part of our life, right from our bikes that we pour petrol into, to the roads, to the cinema tickets, to the website, to the internet costs that we face, and of course, to the policy decisions that we all are impacted by. Your interview with us and spending time with us has given us a lot more confidence in the work that's happening in India. Is that true?
Yes.
Can we give a big round of applause to him for that? Nation above self, you've come to this country from giving up your lucrative job, and you're doing such an amazing job. We wish you God's blessings, and in your growth, we see the growth of the entire country. Thank you
very much. Hari Om.
Thank you very much for being here. Hari Om. Hari Om.